You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I'm excited, apprehensive, terrified, always when it comes to my particular guest at this time. Just as an FYI, as I am transparent all the time, this is the fourth interview in 3 days, so this could be interesting. If anyone listens to the future episode with Stone Malone, it got a bit rambly and weird, so this could end up being the case, and I might make promises I have no intention of keeping. But we're going to do it anyway. I am joined at this time by the owner, proprietor, Big Cheese himself of Bleeding Gums Wrestling, Andrew Crammond. Welcome back.
Thanks for having me. I've heard the name Stone Malone, but I can't think of where. Is he English or is he Scottish?
Scottish.
I've heard that name.
He works Girders, Source, Pro 2, Balor. So
I've definitely heard the name. No, yeah, but thanks for having me back. It's been a little while, I believe.
Yeah, well, last time we did for the SWM podcast, it was a while ago, but it was before your first show, and then we did the Heat Sheet.
Oh yeah, the Heat Sheet
one as well, where we talked about Lust for Death, and then here we are once again, returning for to talk about Wire and Dice and Backlash and Lust for Death and all this stuff that. We started with just one show. Now you've got two upcoming. Although you've got one and a third upcoming.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
But we'll get into all that at some point. But how's it going?
No, it's going all right. It's been an interesting few months and few weeks and whatnot. We are potentially moving forward with shows and stuff that will be after Wire and Ice. Just getting things sorted with that. And fuck me, that's going to be a bit mental when things get announced for that. But more or less just looking into doing the last couple of shows for the rest of the year. And then we can have a nice little break before next year. Because I like to sort of, our friends down south at Kumite, they sort of run their shows like every year's a season. And they don't run like once a month, they'll run every like 2-3 months or whatever. But I think that's the sort of model that we want to sort of base ourselves on, is 1 year's a season, and then we don't start again until the next year, and we'll have a couple of months off at the Christmas period and stuff like that. So yeah, but it's been good.
So I mean, this is going to be running into your, not even your first full year as a fully fledged wrestling promoter. You're already causing controversy online. You're already striking fear in the media, well, me, when I see photos. So it's you've had quite a successful first year, I suppose, and it's not even finished yet because you've still got other shows left to happen. So eye-opening experience, I suppose, for you from previous chats.
It's been. Or are you wearing a Sandman T-shirt, by the way?
No, I've just Budweiser.
Oh right, okay. I was just when I saw that, I was like, is that a Sandman T-shirt? But yeah, no, since from previous chats and stuff, everything's been a bit mental, to be honest. It's been from Lust for Death, which I do feel was a better overall show than Ultraviolence Referendum. I think things are going a lot better and a lot less stressful. But then again, a lot of stuff that's happening now is I do have sort of more connections with people such as W3L and Valor and stuff like that going into Backlash. So there's a little bit less stress, but I'm still stressed like fuck.
So let's talk about Lust for Death then. We'll go through that, because last time we spoke, let's say for Heat Sheet, we talked about the preview of the show, mm-hmm. and we were crowning a first ever Bleeding Gums Wrestling champion. Was it just champion, or was it the UK Deathmatch champion? That was it, of course. Mm-hmm. The beautiful belt with the blood spatter and the light tube.
Don't have it anymore. It's quite upsetting when I would sort of look at the place where I used to keep my belt, and now Caden's got the belt, and it's quite upsetting that I don't get to see it every day when I come home.
You see promoters that just like you get it for doing your promo and doing your matches only. So no, it's gone.
Like, no, it's gone. I think that's part of the prize of the part of the whole purpose of like in wrestling is if you win the championship or you win the tournament or whatever, you keep that trophy and you keep that belt. That's part of what you've won. You know what I mean? I'd feel terrible if I just kept it for myself, like a, you know, hoarding this belt to keep it. No, but Kaden does have the belt on his person at all times.
I would expect nothing less. But you've got the little mini belts, so you've still got plenty of those hanging about. Those look amazing, by the way. I don't have many. I mean, Funko Pops aside, I don't have many wrestling figures in my life anymore. But to see those little belts, I was like, man, that would be cool just to have with you. I think the only action figures I've got are Sabu and the Spirit Squad.
Oh, right, okay. Very good. I mean, Spirit Squad, underrated stable, I should say. And obviously, Sabu's probably arguably one of the best wrestlers of all time. But yeah, Riot Zoo, the guy that makes the little belts, he makes the little minifigures. And he made a Michael Caden, he made a Big Joe, he's made for our shows, he made a Looking Sharp. Who else has he made? Neil Diamond Cutter. I'm sure he's making future ones for Wire and Ice, but I can't spoil who they are. He's got like a Lou Nixon one and an Iceman one and a Jack Harab one. And that man doesn't sleep. Riot Zoo who makes them. But he makes, that's like his full-time job, is he makes like heads and belts for wrestling figures. And that's his full-time gig. So he helps out a lot worse for belts and shit like that.
That's a cool thing. Like nowadays... Like when I had loads of figures growing up, but nowadays it seems like there's a proper market, and there's a proper demand for wrestlers, wrestler figures. It's not all for kids now. It's for.
No, I don't think any of it's for kids. No.
Oh yeah, especially when you see like the sets with the like hands you could take off and the heads. I'm like going, who is this for? This is not for someone who takes that out. This is for stop motion people. Or
yeah, oh definitely.
Yeah. Definitely. But yeah, that's yeah. Just seeing those things, those cool little merch things. I mean, we mentioned before about the Game Boy Advance cartridge, which is still the coolest thing I've ever seen. But it's cool how creative people are being with this kind of medium of wrestling that you can do that. Because we've got an affiliation with Render Bomb, and they've done some stuff for Alton Thorn. They've done the chairs. I think it's
earrings. Oh, yeah, there's like chairs with the green crosses on them for Hellbound.
Yeah, so and they do things like light tube earrings and stuff like that. And I was like, Jesus, that's an amazing thing to to be creative enough to think of that and go, okay, I think I know how to make this, and then make it.
When you go to if you're going to go to like a deathmatch show or shows like that in general, people want to spend money, which is very helpful. But like, if there's all these different guys have got all these different merch, and like Riot Zoo's made all these different belts and figures and things. And like you're saying, people have got mini chairs and like earrings and t-shirts and posters. And it's you could go in there if you've had a few too many, and you could end up spending quite a fair bit of cash on stuff. But that's the bit. Buy the merch. That's what I say.
I know. The last few shows, I've been a little bit skint because everything's just came out one after the other. And when I went to WrestleZone last, there's our mention. The only thing I got was my picture with Gangrel, because that's one wanted.
Oh yeah, Gangrel.
And then as I walked past all the merch, because it was their biggest show of the year, everyone had their merch out, and it was like of some t-shirts, you know, obviously. There was a framed poster of the event that was signed by everyone, which looked amazing, but you know, Bank Balance said no. And then there was Rhys Dawkins, who's got a Shakespeare gimmick. And he was just selling laminate sonnets for a fiver.
That's good.
And people are buying them. And I was looking at it going, I could literally do that myself. but here it is. Just,
in the deathmatch world, a lot of, obviously, people buy bloody ring gear. I mean, I have bloody ring gear in my house, but which says a lot about me. But now a lot of things that we do will have people make like trading cards.
Oh yeah,
but the trading cards are also like stamped with somebody's blood on them, and then they're numbered, and then people buy the trading cards because they're all like, you'll say you'll make 25, and your 25 will have a blood stamp on each one, and then they seem to do quite well at deathmatch shows and stuff, and sell them online and stuff like that. People are a bit fucked in the head, but hey ho, it makes money.
I'm a bit into the trading card thing at the moment, just because this is quite a lot of space to take up and stuff like that. So yeah. I thought, if I'm going to get like guests, I'm collecting cards, but it has to be from guests I've had on the podcast. I think that's that's a cool little way to do it. Which, you know, is easy enough if I've got Scotty Johai, Clang. If I've had Mike Mondo of the Spirit Squad, yep, easy. And then you're looking at other guests going, how the fuck am I going to get a card for you? Because, you know, it's some are easier than others.
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely, definitely. I mean, Riotzoo makes cards for a lot of those guys. He does fucking everything. Everything under the sun, Riotzoo makes cards for loads and loads of deathmatch guys as well. But maybe at some point I'll get myself my own card, but I would feel like, I would feel horrible for actually owning something like that. I would think, oh my God, what an egomaniac. I would think, oh Jesus Christ, can't be up in that.
And you wouldn't know what to do with them, because I've got a bunch of stickers and I'm like, I don't know what to do with these things. Do I hand them to people? How much of a dick do I look? Do I go,
yeah, no, sticker. You just have to give them away. Like, you'll have a t-shirt and there's somehow these stickers just sort of fall in. And, oh yeah, free stickers, but you're just trying to get rid of them.
That's what I did for the trophies recently for the year-end awards. I went to Disco and a bunch, they'd won a bunch of them. So I just like stuffed full like 10 stickers. Like, they can go in there as well.
Yeah, why not?
They'll go somewhere. I'm too much of a I don't want to be caught putting them on lampposts or anything, because I'm just like, oh, that's a faff and a half. If someone...
I mean, I've put them in horrible, dirty nightclubs and places in Edinburgh, but they're the sort of grimy, seedy places that you'd expect to see stuff like that. But, you know.
I just know that if I do it, that's the one time there's going to be some sort of prick that'll go past going, oh, you can't do that. And I'm like,
I like the voice that everybody has, the same generic wrestling fan voice.
Prick voice, that's what it is. we started speaking about Lust for Death and we've just wildly passed it. So yeah, it sounded like it was a good show from what I've heard and, you know, looked through at my fingers there. Popped into mind because Alton Thorne was the first winner of the show in the match when he beat Franco Fate. He's a guy that I kind of want to get on the show, but I know that he's now listened to me cringe about, like, not cringe. Cringe is not the right word, but like boke. Boke's a better word. Boke at things, deathmatch stuff. And I know that he's probably going to spend an hour just making me...
The thing with Alton, I'm really, really good friends with Alton, inside and outside of the wrestling business. I think he's fucking brilliant. I think he's one of the best. But the thing about Alton Thorne is, aside from doing the deathmatch stuff, Alton also does fucking shit tons and has done for many, many years family shows. Mm-hmm. Like, he works for a company called FUTR, Future Wrestling, and he works for various places in like Nottingham, Derby, and all over the place. But they're all family shows. Like the sort of he'll do stuff for like TNT, or he'll do stuff for me, or occasionally like once or twice done stuff for Rise, and predominantly Kumite is where he's known from. But they're like four deathmatch companies. But everything else he does is family friendly wrestling. So he knows his shit. And I'm very, very happy to have him on every show. He's brilliant. And he's a right cunt when he wants to be.
I bet. But yeah, I watched Grapple Theory, I think he did a chat with recently, and he's just so soft spoken and well spoken, and he's just like, I've seen the pictures of what you've been doing at these deathmatch shows. How are you? That's what you always find. I'm always finding that the most like barbaric bastards of wrestlers that are doing all these terrible things.
Nicest guys in the world.
Always seem like the nicest people. Like we've seen Neil Diamond Cutter, like just heading on the train, just casually cutting about. He'll just look like, oh, he wouldn't hurt anyone. And then you see covered in blood, glass everywhere, and you go, how?
Such a happy man. Such a happy man. But Lust for Death first match. Grass. Where were we? What was the first match?
Give it an overall, because we've got loads of other
things. Oh, yeah, yeah. For an overall thing for Lust for Death, I was going to say Grasso's Bloody on the Other Side Deathmatch, but that was from Ultra Violence Referendum. If They Build It, They Will Bleed was that match with that. See, I'm giving myself too many names, like these Panic at the Disco fucking first album titles that I'm confusing myself. So this second show, the venue was fantastic. Aside from where we put the entranceway, because it was right beside the door to the toilets. But I thought that the owners of the establishment were going to be like, fuck this. Look at all this shit you're bringing in, all these boxes of light tubes. And I had a big, huge board of razor blades. And I was bringing in bongs and grinders and fucking saw boards and all this shit. But they were great. The people who had the venue were fucking fantastic, and they want to have us back, which is very, very beneficial because they made a killing on the bar. But no, it was overall, it was a lot less stressful of a show. Still fucking stressful, and we had a few less people on the ring crew. Majority of it was myself, Brian, and Mark. Shout out to Mark Leslie and Brian, always there to help out. Michaela doing the merch as well. But no, it was good. It was a very, very good show. I think we showcased a lot of good fucking ultra-violent deathmatch wrestling. I wouldn't say there was a bad match in the show. We also had a six-man, which we had the British top team against Kirkcaldy's hometown boys, Ewan G. Mackie and Taylor Bryden and Johnny Storm. And Ewan turned on Johnny Storm and ruined the match, and Taylor got destroyed by the British top team. In general, I think it was very, very good. I'm very, very proud of that show. And we also had the good Dr. Leonardo Darwin tear up a Scottish flag in the ring, which was great. Great, great fun, that. But I can't be seen to be saying that. Take away from my character.
I think the big thing that came out of this show, other than obviously the new UK Deathmatch champion, was Tim Strange getting tattooed.
Oh, yeah. Tim Strange getting tattooed. That was, so Tim Strange and Franco Fate both did their first ever death matches on that show. And they both were fucking excellent. Franco Fate had fucking thumbtacks there. Him and Alton Thorne had like a trade-off with thumbtack bats, bashing them in each other's heads. And Franco Fate, you sit here seeing him with a medic, taking everything out, and he's sitting there covered in fucking blood, smiling. And he was loving it. And it's like when you speak to people after they do their first death match or that, check they're okay, and you're like, so are you good? And he's like, yeah, hell fucking yeah, let's do this again. You're like, okay. And Tim Strange was fucking gusset plates, he was had lemons, he got tattooed. Like, yeah, Tim was loving it as well. It was really, really good to have Tim Strange there. But yeah, but you got a genuine tattoo in a match, which is, I think we said that in commentary, me, an Australian and an American, Rafe and John Bullard, we said that's the first time we've ever seen that in a wrestling match ever, so I'm quite proud of that.
So of course, yeah, you mentioned the commentary thing in the heat sheet about trying to get yous all organized to actually do it. So who was the one that was staying up latest or in the morning?
I mean, I think me. I don't know. It's difficult to do. I don't even know it anymore, like what time we did all that, but like that was the first time I could sit down and really enjoy the show, was watching it with those guys. But like John Bullard, the American guy, runs his own company, and he's been involved in wrestling and promoting wrestling and commentating on wrestling for maybe 20 plus years. And then Rafe also does stuff for Dude, Where's My Ring and his own podcast. And just him being there with us, it was really, really good. It was really fun, but it's like three people doing it, like especially when you're not really experienced to doing it, it was very, very odd. But it was good. I felt like we worked quite well in commentary. But yeah, I think it was fun. Tim Strange got tattooed. There was lots of blood. Caden won the belt. We had lots of bloody matches. Neil Diamond Cutter and Caden had the first ever 200 light tube death match in Scottish wrestling history. And yeah, it was a lot of fun. And the show ran a little bit late, but it's a 9 fucking match death match tournament. So I don't know what we're expected to do.
Right, so I mean, I want to 200 light tube death match. I want to just count it. Did you count a legit 200?
Yes, I did. I made sure there was 200 light tubes there.
Is that just for your own peace of mind more than anything else? You didn't think anyone was going to call you on it?
It's for my own ego because I want to do 200 light tubes. Neil Diamond Cutter was in historically the biggest amount of light tubes in one match is 700. Which was late last year, or maybe early this year, was Matt Tremont against Neil Diamond Cutter, 700 light tube death match. There were so many light tubes around the ring that you couldn't actually see in the ring, and that's the record. But we did the first ever 200 ones, and Neil was in that. And I think that was a lot of the story of the match, was that Neil Diamond Cutter is immune to light tubes at this point. They don't really affect him anymore. But yeah, it was really, really good. And I think Caden, when in the tournament, I think he put on 3 very, very good matches, 3 very good performances, and he wrestled looking sharp and stuff like that as well, which was a fun little match too.
So as far as it comes to like feedback now, so both shows are available now on IWTV and DVD, if you're old school like that and like physical media.
Oh, yeah.
So now you're getting a little bit more feedback in that. Is there things that you've been maybe pointed out going, I can maybe do this instead, maybe deathmatch veterans, watchers, that would be able to give you a little bit of advice? Are you quite happy with everything you've kind of put forward so far?
Live, the only thing that's been annoying for both shows, and it's not been the fault of anybody that's doing the music, aside from the first show, to start with until we got it changed over, is there's been music cues and music stuff that's been like 2 seconds have been like the wrong song, or it's been too quiet. Little things like that, but they're not really like that noticeable when you watch on IWTV. But aside from that, the venue's been very dark is something that somebody said to me, but I think that kind of makes it look more grungy and sort of, but I think we're going to completely throw that on its head because the next show is going to be outside.
Yeah, in the middle of summer.
Yeah, exactly, in the middle of summer, so it's not going to be dark. But those have been the only two things. A lot of people have said, do less matches. I want to do a 12-person tournament. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. I think it stands out from everything else. But no, in general, all the sort of comments and feedback from people have been fairly positive and saying I should be proud of myself and we've done very, very well for the second show. And let's move on to the next one.
Like you're saying, it's a tournament. You're expecting more matches on that. If that was a 9-match card and it was just like no interconnecting matches, mm-hmm. you think, okay, maybe that's a bit much. But they all kind of fed into each other eventually in the end. So
we've built from that first show, we've built storylines with Darwin coming in, challenging Davey Blaze. We've built some stuff with Looking Sharp and Dean Ford. We've built stuff with UNG Mackie and Johnny Storm. We had a little mini storyline from the first show to the second show with Michael Caden and Neil Diamond Cutter, because the first show, Neil beat Caden and didn't give him any respect. Caden ended up beating him in the end. And there's like a lot of different sort of the storyline as well, the main storyline into Wire Nice for the No Rope Barbed Wire with Jack Harrop and Alton Thorne, which is the biggest sort of storyline we have in the whole company. We've got a lot of stuff going on that was just from a tournament show that usually doesn't have any of that.
Mm, absolutely. So before we talk about Fire and Ice, because we've got a couple of matches on there, we're going to talk about a show that's going to be happening before then, which will be on June, I've written it down, don't worry about it, June 16th. June 16th, taking place at Glasgow's Grand Ole Opry. Mm-hmm. I'm assuming that's how it's called. Afternoon show, Scottish Wrestling's Backlash, which is conveniently taking place in Glasgow the day after Clash at the Castle as well. You guys haven't fallen into the trap of having to change your show name.
We've not had a cease and desist yet. But I think it's to do with, I don't know, I think the laws about cease and desists are to do with, like, I don't think it's so much to do with the names, I think it's more to do with the logos, mm-hmm. I've heard. So we've not had, anyone's not said anything thus far, but I'm not taking any credit for the name because it wasn't my idea, but it was, is a good name, is a good name for the day after. But yeah, Backlash at the Grand Ole Opry, which is sort of, I would say, Valor's main sort of Scottish venue that they run. But yeah, it'll be a fun day, and it'll be a fun afternoon of wrestling. Be something a bit different for me and for the Bleeding Gums guys and stuff, because it's going to be sort of all age encompassing type thing. So we can't really go completely balls to the walls. There's not going to be weed whackers and razor blade chairs and stuff, but yeah, we'll still be able to go mental, but yeah, it'll be fun, and it's good to see three companies, Valor and W3L, especially W3L being on the go for fucking what, 20 plus years, all getting together to sort of showcase Scottish wrestling.
And I don't know how it's going to work for like, if it's going to go out or anything like that, because I know W3L's got that connection with Progress. Mm-hmm. You, of course, have the connection with IWTV. I think Lou's trying to get something going with Valor. I don't know. I think it might be available in Scandinavian TV. I'm not entirely sure. But when it came to you guys all coming together, was how did it happen? Was it Lou in the middle bringing it together? Who was the kind of instigator for this?
I think it might have been Lou. I can't remember what even really happened with it. It was more just sort of Looking Sharp runs Valor from the Opry. It was more or less he could get the venue. Mike was going to be sort of organising like other aspects of it, such as the ring and things like that. And I was going to do the sort of posters and social media and stuff like that. And it just all sort of came together quite easy, sort of matter of fact. They were like, why don't we just fucking do this? Put it on. It's going to be the first ever Scottish pay-per-view. So let's fucking take advantage of it type thing. But yeah, it's been good. But it, like I've said to you previously before we went on, like it's a bit different for me to be in like a committee of people and of different companies where I'm just sort of used to like, right, okay, like it's a deathmatch show, like let's go and just have a deathmatch show. So we can't go full balls to the walls, blood and violence, but we can still certainly have weapons and certainly do bits and bobs that we could do to sort of showcase. This is a little teaser for what you can expect in July.
That's it, because of course Valor have been kind of skirting that line between just kind of that middle ground of not total adult entertainment but not kids entertainment either. It's like that mid-teen kind of middle ground that they've got with things like they're doing dog collar matches and big street fights and all that kind of stuff as well. So no matches have been announced as yet as we're recording this. We'll probably find out by the time this episode comes out, maybe a couple, one or two. But for yourself, putting together your side of things, your third of it, how easy was it for you? And I suppose when you're looking at people you've had on, you're probably trying to pick between like some of your favourite kids to try and get on this show. But yeah, how easy was it to pick your side of things?
It's been relatively all right. That's the only thing is I'm going to get a cigarette. I'll be 2 seconds and I'll follow this back up.
Okay. Cool. Gives me time to get my notes up. So that. Do we take this out? Probably.
I'll be literally like 30 seconds.
That's okay. I'm just filling time with my voice, so it's just so I can decide whether I'm cutting it out later.
Yeah, that's fine.
I probably won't because I'm lazy.
That's fine. It makes it more real.
That's it. Raw. That's what I like to think.
Exactly.
Raw podcasting.
Right. So for picking, they are cigarettes, by the way. They're not joints. They're just menthols. For picking the guys because WWE have kind of fucked themselves. I know we'll probably talk about this a little bit. Clash at the Castle, when it was in Wales, I went to that, the Principality Stadium. That's, 60,000? Thereabouts? 60,000 seater, yeah. Something like that. But we went to that. And I think they gave the fans maybe 9-10 months notice of that show. For the one in Glasgow, for some reason, that's at the Hydro, this first ever WWE pay-per-view, they've given the fans maybe 2 and a bit months, which is seems a bit late in the day for announcing a big pay-per-view. Also, why is it not at Murrayfield? Why is it not at Hampden? If it's going to be a big fucking pay-per-view thing, then there's a lot of the fact to do with the tickets being mind-numbingly expensive. But for picking the people, that's just me having a moan at WWE there. but I do think that impacts like how I picked people, because a lot of the people that I use on my shows are relatively busy quite a lot of the time. Mm-hmm. So I mean, like people aren't always available for bookings. It's like I spoke to a few people and I was like, are you available? They're like, oh no, we're away at Download. And I was like, oh shit. I was like, yeah, Download Festival's that weekend as well. So it's like, for having the guys that I've got, I'm very, very happy with the people that I've got on it, but it's just kind of like, it's been so last minute. And then I'm having to ask these guys so last minute. And I'm like, sorry, it's so last minute, but it's the fucking WWE. But I'll announce one match on this. That we are doing. So we've got two matches on the show, and this match is going to be, I'm trying to remember the exact name we put for it. I think it was a Steel Clash match, which is going to be a first time ever match. Steel Clash is essentially chairs, cookie sheets, trash cans, things of that nature. Basically, what do the TNA call it? Full Metal Mayhem.
Yeah.
Full Metal Mayhem. It's going to be first time ever, which is a bit metal, they've not wrestled before, but it's going to be Lou Nixon against Jack Harrop. So we're going to have that as our as one of our two matches that we're going to have on the show. But yeah, it's been all right getting the guys up for it and stuff, but it's just, I wish they hadn't have left it so fucking last minute. Because it does seem like you're saying, there's so many different other Scottish shows going around like that weekend that it's like, how are you, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, just from the list that I've got, so the companies we cover, there will be other companies running around about that time as well. But yeah, you've got Power Pro, they've got Thursday. So if you really wanted to, you could go see, I think they'll have a showcase show on Wednesday. So they'll do a showcase show Wednesday, Power Pro will be on Thursday. Then Friday, you can go see SmackDown. And then if you wanted to, immediately afterwards, you can go see ICW After Hours. And then if you're still up for it, you can see the first couple hours of Community Pro Wrestling and then go over to Blockbuster, because they're running about like 2 hours apart.
Is Blockbuster still at the Asylum as well?
Yeah. So you can go there and then you can go see Clash at the Castle, then go see ICW After Hours Night 2, and then Backlash on Sunday. Which, if anyone does that, please let me know.
They're
absolutely batshit crazy, and I want to know everything about it. I'll get the Zoom up, and we'll speak about it. If you hit all 9 shows in that period, then well done you. You have maybe more money than sense, but
well, I think that was like a lot of the reason why we wanted to put stuff on is obviously because it's Scottish wrestling, take advantage of the market, whatnot, but. For the fact of, like, there's a lot of people who have got kids and there's a lot of people who don't necessarily have money to spend fucking 500 quid a ticket to go and see SmackDown or Clash at the Castle, put on something that's like, what, you know what I mean? Like £15-20 to come out and see actual Scottish wrestling. It's insane. I think it sets a very, very bad precedent that the tickets are so high, because they weren't this high for the last Clash at the Castle, but obviously it's a bigger arena. Mm-hmm. But now WWE will think, we could do it anywhere and charge whatever we want, and we'll just charge everything. And it's I don't know. I just think it's insane. It's insane the amount of money that they're charging for tickets for Clash of the Castle.
And it's probably going to sell out. So it's not going to, yeah, like you're saying, they're just going to sit there and go, that's sold out. Well, we can still charge that for other shows like that. Watch out Berlin when tickets go out for Bash in Berlin. I can't see the Germans accepting it as much as we've just rolled.
I'm actually going to that show. Bash at Berlin, which is a terrible name, I think, for a show. But me and my friends were sat there, and my friend Larry, he's fan of AEW, fan of WWE. We're like, what are we going to do? Are we going to go to see All In 2? Or is it 3?
2. No, well, I think it's the second one in Wembley. But yeah, I think
second one in Wembley. But he was like, we could go to that, or do you want to go to Berlin? I was like, hell yeah, let's go to Berlin. I don't give a fuck about seeing the wrestling. I just think a night out or nights out in Berlin would be better than London. Mm-hmm. But
and also, the Euros are on, if you like that sort of thing. So Scotland are in the Euros, that weekend?
Are they? Fucking hell.
Yeah, I think Scotland's playing the Friday, possibly. I don't know when the Euros start. I'm not a football guy, so it's not something that I really pay attention to.
You better be expecting me to go to that as well. I'm a fuck.
I've seen all the discourse about it going, but the football's on. And I'm looking at it going, so?
I think that there's obviously like a big, there's obviously hundreds of thousands of millions of football fans. I don't think the wrestling football thing really crosses over that much for people to really that to affect, like, you know what I mean, the sort of Bash at Berlin stuff.
That's Clash of the Castle thing. So it just means how many flyers have you got, just out of curiosity?
I've not got them printed yet, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to get my flyers, I'm going to get double-sided. So I'm going to have the Backlash on one side and then I'm going to have Wire and Ice on the other side. And I'll fly the fuck out of it. Because unbeknownst to me, I'll just say this and everybody will think I'm an arsehole for it, but my friend Larry, shout out to him again, he's a cunt. He's managed to get some sort of fiddled his way through, and we are actually going to Clash at the Castle, much to my disappointment against my morals and my principles. But it will be a very, very good opportunity to flyer the absolute fucking shite at that place. If I get chucked out for flyer, I don't care. I'm not that interested. But yeah, I'll have a shitload of flyers for both shows.
You'll wait until like just as if Drew wins, if he's in that match with Damian Priest, as it's rumored as we're chatting. Right after he wins, just chucking what you've got.
Throw
left.
Them.
Just throw them.
Throw them everywhere. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Why not? What are they going to do?
Exactly. Throw me out. The match is finished. So
it's fine. Escort me out. It's fine. I'll get past all the queues to get out. It'll be fine.
I'm just really curious to see what like the aftermath of SmackDown clashes. Where I'm seeing all these, there'll be so many photos of leaflets for like for yourselves, for Blockbuster, for all these promotions that are happening nearby as well. That's going to be like just everywhere. It's going to be the biggest advertising opportunity for Scottish wrestling.
Oh ever. Yeah, it's really really good. But I imagine that we'll probably have on the Friday and the Saturday. I imagine like myself, and I assume that W3L and Valor and stuff will have teams of people out everywhere, flyer and stuff. So yeah, it'll be fun. It'll be an interesting weekend that weekend.
Just do the old Spider-Man point thing when you see someone from Community Pro or something doing flyering, and you're just like handing them off, passing them to each other, just going, "I'll take one if you taking," and just go along like that, and then put it in the bin. But yeah, it's mad. It's a mad weekend that's coming up, and I as soon as it was announced, it was too, like you're saying, it was way too short notice. I knew I was not going. That was just no way.
I am not paying a penny for mine, all due to my friend Larry, who's an arsehole. But through him, he's managed to get us tickets for it. I'm not paying a single penny for it, because I would grudge paying money for it, because I think it's disgusting how much money that it is. But I'm essentially just using it. And I was going to go and flyer anyway. But I was like, okay, well then, if I'm going to go, I'm going to make the best of it. And I'll flyer Bleeding Gums, and I'll flyer the Backlash show. So it's a win-win.
Get all the merch on, get all the Bleeding Gums gear on, and just advertise the fuck. That's the best way to do it. But no, as soon as it was announced, like, nah, not a chance. And then other things are happening. So I'll be... I kept saying I'll watch it with my wee boy, but he'll be asleep, so I'll be myself. They'll be watching that show by myself.
When does it even start? 6:30, 7 or something?
Something like that, yeah. So he should be long asleep by that point, because we can't moan about restless nights, because he sleeps a fucking dream. So
that's a good thing. That's a good thing, though.
I know. He gets up at like 3 for a whinge, and that's about it. I'm like, if that's the worst of it, I think I'm okay. I think I'll do. Still tired to fuck. Don't understand it. Don't understand how that works. especially now. I mean, the heat at the moment. But hang on, this is a wrestling podcast. So not.
No, I mean, but it is. But that's what I'm sitting there thinking to myself. Like, if we've got weather like we've had in like the last week or so, like we could have that for Wire Nice. Like, oh, fucking, be fucking lovely.
So let's talk about. So last plug, Glasgow's Grand Ole Opry, Scottish Wrestling's Backlash. Three promotions coming together for one afternoon of pro wrestling. Keep an eye on the socials. We'll announce matches as they go up. A match has already been announced with oh my god, Lunix and Jack Arup.
Yep.
Yes. Memory. So go check it out. It'll be announced and we'll put it out everywhere as well. So just in case anyone from WWE is listening, even though we have said terrible things about your policy for tickets and the disgusting prices they are, I still won't say no to any press and media.
Yeah, I mean, if they want to invite me to do anything or be on anything, I'll have Bleeding Gums t-shirts and all sorts.
If I get an interview with anyone from WWE, if anyone wants to send me merch, like stick it in the background and just have it there, just let me. I'll give you my address. I don't mind.
I don't know if they're gonna go like when they did the Clash at the Castle in Wales. When we went there, which was really, really good fun for the drinking purposes and whatnot. I was more enjoying the night after the last Clash at the Castle was an AEW pay-per-view. And I had more fun drinking and being out in the bars. We went to like a wrestling like pub quiz, and then we watched AEW's pay-per-view, whatever it was, All Out or something like that. It was in like a bar, and we sat and watched that. That was great. But they had like big banners like over like all the lights into town, and they had these big huge like latexy laminated banner things everywhere, and people are trying to steal them off of lampposts and shit. So I don't know if WWE are going to go that mental for the Scottish one, because it's a bit smaller, but it'd be nice if they did.
And then just to throw out a separate disclaimer, if you find one and want to donate it to the SWN cause, then again, I will send you my address. I'm not fear. You just send it to me and I'll have it in about this. I don't know how much Kelly will enjoy that, but I'll have it somewhere here. Don't you worry.
If I get the opportunity to steal one, I'll steal one and I'll send it to you, Billy.
I know. I've got a big space here. It just needs something in that corner. I used to have a WrestleMania 19 chair there, but it's been somehow commandeered into a makeup station. So it needs the Thor's hammer's doing nothing. Sorry, Mjolnir to the nerds. It's doing nothing in that corner.
I can see it there.
I know. I really should give that to the boy, but it's too cool. I'm keeping it. It's fine. Anyway, weather nice. We'll get into the actual proper show coming up. Not the Backlash isn't a proper show, but this is the full Bleeding Gums experience. Yeah. Will be Wired and Ice, which will take place on the 20th of July at the Ice Factory in Perth. We've got a couple matches announced already. We've got four, according to my diligent research. One of which is going to be very interesting to speak about from our pre chat, but we will navigate it in the best way we possibly can.
Yep.
So, like you're saying, one of the big stories coming out of the last show, Lust for Death, was Alton Thor and Jack Haddock. Mm-hmm. And they're in the first ever, in Scotland, no rope barbed wire match.
Yep.
Was that always kind of a match you had in mind to have, but you didn't want to just, like, kind of blow your load early by having it straight away? You wanted to kind of craft a story to get to it.
I always wanted to do that match, but yeah, I needed to have a story to go with the match. But like with Jack Harab and Alton Thorne, they had a match. The first show that Grasso was playing, another side match, which to me and for a lot of the people that were there was the best match of the show. Then at Lust for Death, we had Jack Harab won his three-way, where Tim Strange got that tattoo, and Alton Thorne won his first round match. And Jack Harab went to the bar to get a wee glass of water or something, and then Alton Thorne attacked him and threw him through like a big sheet of glass. And he essentially more or less nearly took him out of the semi-final three-way that was Alton Thorne, Neil Diamond Cutter, and Jack Harab. And because of that, he was fucked. And Alton Thorne smashed him over the head with a big fucking light. I made that bundle, so I think there was 15 light tubes in that bundle. And ended up pinning Jack Harab and sort of stole his dreams of becoming the Bleeding Gums Wrestling UK Deathmatch Champion. But it's one of the main matches that's got the biggest amount of story build. They both fucking hate each other. And then Jack Harab took the mic, did a promo in the ring. I put it up on YouTube. I put it up on Instagram and everything. And basically asked me to go to ringside and stuff like that. And I shook his hand and said, yeah, let's fucking do it. And it's going to be the first time ever in Scotland. We had one ICW with, I think it was Jester and McIntyre, but it was advertised. I went to that show. It was advertised as a barbed wire ropes match. And I was like, oh, no rope barbed wire. But it wasn't. It was just barbed wire around the ropes. So this is a proper fucking no rope barbed wire match where we're taking the fucking ropes down. We're putting up no rope barbed wire. And it'll be something fucking insane. And I think it'll be a sort of feud ender. And both those guys are really looking forward to it. And it'll be fucking mental. And we've got some t-shirts already made for that I got made by the legendary deathmatch designer, Sai Ozawa, for that show. So yeah, it's going to be a fucking mental match. It's got a lot of fucking heat and a lot of hatred behind it. So yeah, it's going to be fucking nuts.
What I liked about it, when we obviously you love your puns when it comes to the match types and what have you. This one doesn't have that.
No,
you know, it, all the rest of them have like a fun title for a death match, but this one's just straight
it's
up.
It's not barbed wire.
It's, barbed match.
Because it's one of my favorite matches of all time. Is Sabu against Terry Funk in ECW, Born to Be Wired, no rope barbed wire death match, and I love no rope barbed wire matches. And the fact that I get to put on the very ever first one ever in Scotland's kind of scary, and I hope it goes well and everybody's enjoying it. But I think it will be history making, and I think it will be really good.
But no, you brought up the one ICW did. I think that was the one where they announced it, and then like 2 weeks later, Drew got re-signed to WWE. So they were like, well, he's not wearing that barbed wire at all.
Even at that point, I wasn't expecting it to be like the best sort of no rope barbed wire match of all time. But when they announced it, I was like, holy shit, they're doing no rope barbed wire. So I bought a ticket for that. And then they had the wire in the ropes, and I was like, oh. I was like, that's not the same. That's not the same thing. But
anyway, but yeah, I do remember that was one of the big that kind of thing. And then it was just Jester getting thrown into it because, you know, don't want to injure the big star who's now possibly, perhaps, the next WWE World Heavyweight Champion, you know. So anyway, but yeah, so that was the first match announced. I haven't even said when doors open. It's an afternoon show. 3:30 doors open, 4 PM. Tickets are possibly limited. I'm assuming if they are available, it will be limited at bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk. So go get your tickets there. So yeah, that was the first batch announced. That was the big one, being the no ropes barbed wire match with Alton Thorne and Jack Haddock. The other matches we've got, so three more. First one being the Red Dead Red Death match. Say that five times fast. we have Tim Strange and Big F and Joe. So Tim Strange, he got tattooed, had his first death match, and he's back for more. So, mm-hmm. How about this one?
So Tim's, I've gotten to know Tim quite well, over the last few months and stuff. I love Tim. Tim's fucking brilliant. But this is, Tim wants to be in death match. He wants to fucking go both feet full in, as they say. He doesn't want to fuck about, and he challenged Big Joe. Big Joe accepted the challenge, and we got to pick the stipulation. So Red Dead Red Death match, Tim Strange is a cowboy, and I don't want to ruin what that stipulation is, but it's going to be fucking mental. I think that, oh God almighty, I'm even worrying about some of the stuff that we're going to have to do in that match, but it's going to be fun, and they're both two big, big fucking guys. And both Joe and Tim know each other as well, really, really well from a lot of family shows and various shows and traveling around and stuff like that. So yeah, it'll be fucked up, and another first time ever. I'm sure they've probably wrestled each other before, but first time ever death match between the two of them. And it's good to see Big Joe against somebody who's his size.
It's just
Joe are huge.
It's good. Well, Tim's been around for ever. What would it be, 20 years probably? Not 20 years. Yeah, probably about 20 years. So he's been around a good time, and now he's getting into the deathmatch game. So he's got a little bit of catching up to do, I suppose. And Big Joe's gonna catch him up quite quickly, I reckon.
Joe's a tournament of survival next Saturday, which is GCW's big fucking tournament. He just posted up a video about him going over there and stuff. And I fucking love Big Joe to death. He's the nicest, best fucking guy. The face of British deathmatch wrestling. So, yeah, it'll be fun. And I think a lot of people will be pretty fucking shocked and disgusted at what we're doing for that match. But I won't ruin it until today. But Red Dead for deathmatch, why not?
Is this the time that guns are brought into wrestling? That's the big
question. I'm not going to say anything at all.
You don't have to confirm or deny anything, but I think that's always the thing that makes me laugh about. What makes me laugh about deathmatch wrestling, but the fact that if there's no rules or anything like that, why not bring a gun? Just bring a gun. What's the other going to do?
It'd be a lot easier to do that in America than to do it here. I mean, you know.
That is true. That's very true. What can we do here? Crossbow. Actually, no, I don't want to give you ideas. Let's just move on. So the next one. Next of the deathmatch trio that we have on this card already is this is the one we're going to speak about. We'll do it as controversy free as possible. We've got the Holiday from Hell deathmatch. It's Lou King Sharp against the infamous Dean Ford, who I think in the last couple of weeks has definitely become infamous in Scottish wrestling, especially in the Perth and at Dundee and Angus area. Luke King Sharp, he's Blood Tourist, but was last show his first proper deathmatch?
He's done deathmatch, but the last, his match against Big Joe, they actually fucking won, which I think shocked a lot of fucking people. That was his first match where he actually used light tubes. And Looking sharp, did amazing in that match. And then in the semis, he lost to Michael Caden in a Full Metal Fuck It death match. Looking sharp against Big Joe was fucking great. I think that was probably arguably one of the best matches of the whole show. Big Joe got on the mic at the start of the thing and said, "Fucking get up, you fucking lazy cunts," and got all the crowd to come like right round ringside. They brawled outside. Looking sharp got thrown on a skip. Mm-hmm. It was great, great fun. But yeah, him against Dean Ford, the infamous Dean Ford, Holiday from Hell death match, which will be a lot of fun.
Right, Holiday from Hell, you'd expect that to be a bit more Christmassy, is it? Because it's just because of the ice factory, the cold nature of the venue kind of thing. Holiday from Hell, how'd you come from that?
So, just because 95% of the people are going to be on holiday.
Oh yeah, summer holidays.
Because it's the holiday, because it's the summer and stuff. But what the plan is, there's going to be a lot more to it than this, but you would get matches that have got like mystery boxes.
Ooh.
Instead of like mystery boxes that have got mystery weapons in them, we're going to have suitcases that have got mystery weapons in them. And we're going to have various other different things. And it's going to be a sort of summertime death match. I don't want to spoil any more than that. There's going to be suitcases. That's all I'm going to say.
I've realized how old I've gotten when I didn't realize that it's happening during the summer holidays.
I don't even mean the summer holidays. I just mean
it's a good connection that Holiday from Hell and it's summer holidays. So yeah, I'm sitting there just going, oh yeah. There's holidays. I haven't had one of those in the summer since, how old am I now? 33. So probably for 15 years. So it's been a while. So that's just to age me terribly, as all these podcasts eventually do. There's a big, I think this is going to be one that's going to be, eyes are going to be on it for the right or wrong reasons, but eyes are certainly going to be on this match.
Yep.
for many reasons. For the infamous Dean Ford and Liu Kang Sharp, who they've got history as well. Yeah. They've come up in the same places. They've probably wrestled each other a good few times elsewhere without the stipulation intact. So
yeah.
It's definitely a lot of history that possibly will be delved into in the coming weeks.
I said this to Brian the other day. It was like, it's very rare that you actually see a death match between two people from Scotland. There's always usually a Scottish, like the shows that I do anyway, there's always usually a Scottish person versus an English person. This, I think this is the first thing they've actually had two Scottish people wrestling in an actual death match against each other. But yeah, but Dean Ford attacked Looking Sharp after the Lust for Death tournament, and he's back with his new gimmick. And everybody seems to be, well, certain people seem to be up in arms about it and whatnot. But yeah. It was very, very happy. He put out a video and stuff like that, and I thought it was amazing. And I think the match will be very, very fucking good between the two of them.
I think I've seen Dean do things with, I might be misremembering, but I might have been actually on a Bleeding Gum show with things like thumbtack, kick pads and stuff like that. So
He wrestled Lou Nixon, Taipei, and thumbtack.
That was it. I knew I saw it somewhere, and of course it was Bleeding Gums.
That was Dean Ford's first death match. So after that show, I can't remember when it was, but I think Dean took some time off, and now he's back, and he's reinvented himself.
No, I quite like. It's just a throwback for myself that he had the old skull hoodie zip up. It just reminded me of Scott Steiner when he got abducted by Samoa Joe, and then he in TNA, and he came back with the. Apparently he was all scarred and that, and then he took off the hoodie and he was just...
I don't even remember that. Steiner. I remember when Samoa Joe was like an island warrior and he had a cock on his face.
It was the same time.
when TNA ruined Samoa, and I was like, oh no. But then again, Scott Steiner's promos were always fantastic back then, but oh dear.
When Samoa Joe got abducted by ninjas and then someone drew a cock on his face. Yeah, that was right about the same time. Really got a big, big knife.
The death of TNA at the time, I think that was.
One of many. If anyone from TNA is listening, I do enjoy the press passes and I will continue to take take part in them. Even though I absolutely 100% know PCO did not understand a fucking word I said on the last press pass.
I mean, to be fair, like, I mean, you said that to me previously, that you were going to do something with PCO. Like, I think PCO's done various different sort of deathmatch stuff. Like, he did one of those, he's wrestling ICW in Old Bard. He did that match, I can't remember who was in it, against Steve Macklin? Mike Macklin?
Mm-hmm.
I bled like fuck. And he did that fucking cinder block bump with attacks and shit. And PCO's a nutter. But I really like PCO. He was like in the, like, if anybody like watches wrestling from like 1984 or 1985, which you shouldn't from WWF, he was in the Quebecers, and they were tag team champs for fucking donkeys. And like, they had fucking Johnny Polo, who was Raven, as their manager and stuff like that. Like, good times, good times.
Well, I said to him that I don't know if he just kind of went into a brain fog afterwards, but the first thing I said to him was, like, I own three VHS tapes that I watched on loop, WWF ones: King of the Ring 2000, WrestleMania 15, and Royal Rumble 94. So I loved that match between the Hearts and the Quebecers.
Is 94 Bulldog and Brett?
No, that was Luger, Brett.
Luger and Brett, that's what it is. That's what it is. There we go.
So, yeah, so I watched that.
95's when it's Michaels and Bulldog are through the whole thing.
It's only half an hour long, so it seems it's less impressive.
It's also a worse Rumble. Anyway.
It's terrible. It's like, to be honest, don't get me started, because I think Iron Man match between Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels is boring as fuck. So, you know.
I mean, you have to have... I mean, yeah, it's pretty shite.
It's all right. I'll throw out a worse one just to appease the Bret and Shawn fans. I thought Steamboat and Savage was fine. There you go. It was fine.
I'm an unashamable fan of the, and it's the only wrestling figure that I've bought, like, currently that I've actually enjoyed. I'm waiting on it getting arrived, and it's the Honky Tonk Man. I love him. I think he's fantastic. Like, I want him to do a little tour of Scotland. That'd be amazing.
He did disco, but it was just like for their award show. So you never know. We could would we just have Honky Tonk just come out and smash someone with a guitar, and then that's it. Yeah.
Great. Just to pop me, have him do a Q&A, just get him drunk and just have him rant and rave. And because to me at this point, like now, like on like a couple of nights ago, all my friends were like, oh, have you watched this show, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, no, sorry. I was watching, like, a seven-hour, like, superstar Billy Graham, like, shooting review. I was like, must have missed it. Like, I don't know. I just don't... It's different times, different times.
You see Beefcake, Brutus Beefcake's been announced for Comic-Con up in Aberdeen.
I'm not that... If they announced, like, Greg the Hammer Valentine or Honky Tonk Man, I'd be mildly interested, but I don't really care about Brutus Beefcake. I don't really... Not a fan.
I just find it so weird. Like, it's like... Of all the names you can get from the 80s, 90s, like, Beefcake? Why?
The thing is, it'll be busy.
Absolutely. I mean, when Hacksaw was over, he was apparently at an absolute
light. Hacksaw's good crack, though. Hacksaw's good crack. And he's like, he tells, like, interesting sort of funny stories. Like, my favourite thing of all time, aside from, like, matches and whatnot, is kayfabe commentaries, where people just shooting reviews of the best thing in the world.
I used to watch a bunch of them, like, when I was younger. You used to rip them off, like, a website called Stage View, I think it was. You used to just rip them off and just
buy the tapes.
All right. All right. No, I ripped them off and pirated them like a wrestling fan.
That's okay then.
I didn't pay for shit when I had unlimited internet and the wherewithal. Everything's cracked down or available at cheap prices now. It's ridiculous. It's disgusting. No. It's disgusting, really.
Yes.
Bring back pirating. Maybe not. That's possibly not the best message to come out of this. So, elsewhere, we've talked about the three matches, death matches that have been announced. There's been one match confirmed, one match that was requested at the last show, at Lust for Death. So, we'll go with the one that's requested, which is Davey Blaze against Leo Darwin. Remember rightly, so we don't know if that's not been official. There's no graphic for it yet, but it's been requested. It's been put out in the ether. Can you reveal, can you confirm that match is happening, or we just have to wait?
We've not had Davey Blaze's response to that, but that promo that Leonardo Darwin cut on that show was something amazing. I thoroughly enjoyed that. Very, very funny. But yeah, I assume at some point Davey Blaze will attack Leonardo Darwin and have a go and do a promo on that, and we'll get that match announced. But that promo at Lust for Death was probably one of my most favourite things on the show. I thought it was very, very funny, and he took the fucking piss out of everybody that was there and everything. But it was great. It was a sight to behold. If no one's seen that, get it on IWTV. I might post that full promo up on YouTube or something. But oh Christ almighty, great fun, great fun.
I mean, it begs the question, and if Blaze hasn't responded yet, maybe we have to keep an eye on Backlash. Just, you never know. Never know, we might get a little bit of a tease. I don't know. It's like, that's just me throwing it into the world. That's not anything that you have to confirm or deny. It's just just keep an eye on all the Bleeding Gums socials. That's probably the best thing to do, and
exactly
see where that goes. Another match that's been announced is the one that kind of started from Lust for Death as well. It was Johnny Storm taking on UNG Mackey. Now, I know for a fact that these guys have known each other for a very long time. I've spoke to you very recently, and him and Johnny have had a very, very good relationship in the past, and it's now all broken down in Bleeding Gums Wrestling. So not a death match, but we know what Ewing can be like, a bit sneaky and nefarious, and Johnny Storm is Johnny Storm. So when you see this match on a card, does this kind of tickle your kind of being a wrestler fan from early 2000s to now? How do you feel about this one in particular?
It's more for Ewan sort of fucked over Johnny Storm. I think Johnny wasn't giving Ewan the tag in that match. A lot of it was Taylor Bryden being destroyed with the BTT, and a lot of the times it would be Johnny getting the tag as opposed to Ewan, and Ewan had enough of it. And then Johnny chased Ewan backstage, left Taylor Bryden to the Wolves as the BTT. And now they're going to have a match at Wire Nice and sort of settle their differences. And I think that Ewan is maybe slightly pissed off with a lot of the sort of love and affection and things that people have had for Johnny Storm over the years and things like that, and thinks enough's enough. But I think it'll be a very, very, very good match because both those guys can wrestle their fucking arses off. And we will see what Ewan has to say at some point soon about why this match is actually happening.
Well, I don't think anyone can deny that when Ewan speaks, people listen. So I'll be very interested to hear about that. So that's what we've got announced. We've got four matches, one little tease, the possibility on there as well. I'm assuming another match or two will be thrown in there when we get there, as we get closer to July 20th at the Ice Factory for Wire and Ice. So just to remind folk, if you've forgotten somehow, the doors open 3:30, bell time 4 p.m. Tickets available, bleedinggirlswrestling.co.uk. Big night. So this is show three for Bleeding Gums. Three and a third when it comes around the old Naked Gun.
Oh God, you're saying that to me. I'll have to write all the Naked Gun things down and make puns out of them.
Well, I haven't been a Naked Gun one, but I thought, you know, I'm gonna help with the puns here. These are not very good. I'm just gonna warn you that now. So I was thinking, you know, oh, you like your puns, we'll throw in some. So for your Christmas show, I went for Blood Actually. That was okay.
That's not bad. I like that.
That was the best one. My brain shut off after that.
I like that. Never start with your best. Never start with your best.
Well, that was the first one I thought of, and then my brain just went, "You're done."
Blood actually is good.
So the next one was Need for Bleed. I thought that's a bit shit, to be honest.
Need for Bleed, but a lot of places have done. Various companies have done Blood, Sweat, and Beers, which I'm like, I don't want to do that.
Yeah, and the last one I had here was Glass Effect, but that's more for the video game nerds, the old Mass Effect thing. But yeah, After Blood, actually.
I've never played any Mass Effect games. I'm not an RPG person.
Yeah, Blood Actually was the best one, and then my brain.
Blood Actually is a very good game.
That's it.
You're gonna have to trademark that before I actually take it. I mean, I do have the names for the future shows, but I will announce them. We'll probably be announcing them at Wire Nice. Mm-hmm. But one of them is no one's gonna get it, but I'll say it on this. I'll say it in this. It's a reference to an episode of Columbo, which is one of my favorite fucking TV shows of all time. I love Columbo. So one of the show's names is a reference to Columbo, because I just like to pop myself sometimes, and I love that fucking show. But yeah.
So there you go. Get guessing, folks, if you want to guess.
I'd like to see somebody try and pick them up. I'd like to see somebody try and pick them up. But no, yeah, but I think we're going to have, I think overall, we're going to Wire Nice. There's going to be another 3 shows for the rest of the year after that. But yeah, but we'll announce the 4th and 5th one at Wire Nice.
And then... And that's the season. Is that the season?
Well, there'll be one more after that. Right. There will be 6 altogether. Okay. Well, sorry, 5 altogether. But that'll be it for the year.
And as far as people you want to get in, I mean, again, I'm sure you're not going to give me any spoilers. In that case, you have to keep an eye on social medias to find out more. But has there been people that you've got on your bucket list that are still to tick off that you want to try and get on these shows that are... maybe not just deathmatch wrestlers, but folk that you've seen in your travels, because I know you like to travel to other promotions to not only flyer, but to also check out some of the wrestlers that are on board. Is there, have you got a list of people you wanted to try and scratch off over the next few events?
I don't want to give anything away, but the show after Wire Nice will have a lot of people that I'm ticking off my bucket list. And, a lot of them are international people, so it'll be a bit fucking mental. I'm still putting what do they say, crossing T's and dotting I's as we go for stuff like that. But no, I mean, a lot of the people that I've got already are a lot of people that would have anyway. But I don't know what my fucking cat's doing. Anyway, but no, I can't spoil anything because it'll ruin the sort of mystique of what we're gonna do.
Fair, that's absolutely fair. Like, I'm not a journalist. I'm not gonna try and poke you any further for that information. You just have to keep an eye on the socials for it. I was gonna make you an offer. I was gonna say over the summer, if I get my hands on or go into IWTV to watch, I think I'm gonna dip my toe in. I'm gonna watch the first show and I'm gonna review it. That's my plan and thought over the summer. I don't know if I'm going to record me watching it, because I don't think anyone's going to see that.
Go for it.
So that is the plan and hope. If it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, then clearly I watched the first couple of matches. And went,
oh. Well, I mean, for the first show, the first 3 matches are not death matches. The first 3 are a scramble. We've got Looking Sharp against Nathan Black, and we've got HD Drake against Yuji Maki. Mm-hmm. And then I believe only from match 4 onwards is deathmatch. So from the first show,
I think I owe it to your hospitality for coming on and speaking, and for everyone that every time I mention going, it's not for me. Everyone coming back going, you don't know until you try. So I think I need to get this
definitely. This, I mean, or if you're happy to come down to Wire Nice, always a place. If you wanted to come down and view all the sort of nonsense, because I mean the whole show is more or less sort of half and half, mm-hmm. Of death matches and quote unquote normal matches, but we will have, there's a lot more sort of Scottish talent on Wire Nights as there've been to previous shows.
Sorry, I'm just waiting. You guys are coming closer and closer to me. I'm just waiting for trying to think of a town that's close enough to me that it's, I can't really. Heath.
If I could find I find a venue to run in Aberdeen, I'd do it.
I'm sure there's plenty. I'm sure there's Okay, right, that's fine. Like I said, I knew there was going to be a promise that I would burst out and go, ah, oh, shit, now I've said it, I'm really going to have to try and keep it. But yeah, I'm going to watch the first one. I'm going to get Ultra Violence Referendum. We're going to watch it, and I'll see how I do it, whether it's going to be written form or if we figure out how Twitch works. If not, YouTube, I don't know. It's fine. I've got plenty of time to think about it. But yeah, so we've got, I was lots to fit in that time. We talked about Backlash, talked about Lust for Death tournament, and of course, people should be getting their tickets for Backlash and Wire and Ice as it goes out. So anything you want to plug before we wrap up here and then go on the post show where we moan about things we definitely can't put onto a podcast?
I'll plug these, I'll go for a piss, and then we can moan about things that we can't possibly put in a podcast. So Backlash, get your fucking tickets. It's going to be three different companies. W3L have run for 20 odd fucking years. Valor, who were Copenhagen Championship Wrestling before then. Two companies that have got a lot more experience and a lot more know-how and everything than me, and then I'm somehow just involved in all this as well with having my guys up. Like I've said, the first match announced for that is Lou Nixon against Jack Harrop and a Steel Clash match. Don't want to say death match, just in case, you know, it puts the kiddie-winks off. But get your tickets for that, the Grand Ole Opry. There's a full bar. It's in the afternoon. Get yourself a little hair of the dog after you've been to spending 85,000 grand at the fucking Hydra the night before. And then, obviously, get your tickets for Wire Nice, which I think we're doing. That Wire Nice is sold better than, like, almost the last two shows combined, like, quick-wise, for what we're doing so far. Outdoor, summer, deathmatch, first ever Scottish no-rope barbed wire. We've got a barbecue. There's going to be eight matches. Half of them are death matches, half of them are normal matches. Yeah, it'll be fun. Go to www.bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk for tickets. But yeah, it'll be fun. And then we are going to have more shows that are going to be announced soon. And I am anticipating and panicking for what's going to happen so far. But yeah, no, that's about it, really.
Excellent. Well, I think I've got through this one without like the fear. The last two times we have chatted about it, but I think I'm now getting used to it. Like I said, I'm getting a little bit more warmed to deathmatch wrestling. So we'll see over the summer if I finally bite the bullet and stop being a bitch and watch it. But no, for now, thank you very much for taking time to chat, and looking forward to see what happens with Backlash and Wire Nice and everything else Bleeding Gums. So yeah, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me on. Cheers. We'll be right back.